Hachette Audio presents Grief is Love, Living with Loss, written and read by Marisa Renee Lee. For my mother, Lisa, who taught me everything I need to know about love. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 4. Grief is love. My mother lives in the water, and the fluidity, the comfort, and the power of water is where I find her. I run to the water when things get hard. I can find her in a warm bath, in the fresh scent that emerges after a light spring rain, in the vastness and overwhelming power of the ocean. And just as I need water to live, I stubbornly refuse to live without the love of my mother. And you don't need to live without the love of your person either. We are taught that grief is something that arrives in the immediate aftermath of death. And while that's certainly true, it's not the whole story. Grief is the experience of navigating your loss, figuring out how to deal with the absence of your loved one forever. It's understanding that the pain you feel because of their absence is because you've experienced a great love. That love doesn't end when they die, and you don't have to get over it. My hope in writing this book is to give those of us who know loss and those who care to understand our experiences a bit of guidance for living a full life after losing someone we love. A life where we can continue to love them, grieve them, and honor them on our terms. I've written what I wish I knew when I lost my mother 14 years ago, and the many lessons I've learned since. As I sit writing this on October 18th, 2021, the United States has lost more than 720,000 lives to COVID-19. Globally, we've lost 4.5 million people to this pandemic. Like you and me, each of these people has left behind loved ones who are, for the first time, trying to figure out life after death. We can no longer afford to ignore grief, to relegate it to whispered conversations, to expect folks to navigate their brokenheartedness on their own. It is neither practical, nor possible, nor humane. My mother, Lisa, took her last breath on February 28th, 2008, 10 days after turning 49. I was with her when life left her body. I did the thing that I had prepared for as her daughter and one of her caretakers, the thing I promised her. I ensured she died on her own terms, the way she wanted to, in our home. I was 25, and it felt like the epitome of adulting. But what I didn't know, what no one told me, was that her death was also a beginning. Her death sparked a new life for me. At 5:37 p.m. that day in February, I was forced to start learning how to live without her, how to somehow live a full and joyful life with a permanent hole in my heart. When she died, I was unmoored. I was an adult in name only, and just as I was trying to sort through who I was and how I wanted to show up in the world, my sense of self was destroyed. Losing my mother meant losing myself too. Who would I be without my mother? We are irrevocably changed when we lose someone we love because so much of who we are is a reflection of the people who love us, and now one of those people is gone. In the beginning, the mere act of sustaining your own life feels impossible. But I promised my mother I would be fine, so I returned to my life. The act of returning is often the hardest part. What does life look like without her, without my person? We don't know, but we push ourselves to do it anyway, sometimes by force. And I am nothing if not the epitome of a strong Black woman, a type A striver. I may as well have, "I've got this," tattooed on my back. I returned to my job on Wall Street and my wannabe Sex in the City existence 2 weeks after my mom's death, and I did the thing Black women have been doing for centuries. I kept my mouth shut about the extent of my pain. As I attempted to cobble together the former pieces of myself with what was left, I thought it was normal to feel sad for perhaps the first few weeks. I didn't know it was normal to feel sad on and off for years, for what feels like it will be for the rest of my life. I didn't know anger, envy, frustration, depression, anxiety, and shame were common elements of grief. I did not understand the importance of grace and the need to extend it to myself and others. I had no idea that grief was actively impacting my body and my brain in ways that made maintaining my health, my career, and my relationships challenging. I didn't know all of these things were grief. And perhaps more importantly, I didn't know all of these things were normal. So I fought them, and I hid them, and I lied about them to myself and others. I assumed there was something wrong with me for having so many feelings about a dead mother. I was embarrassed and ashamed. So I did my best to keep my feelings to myself, if I even acknowledged them at all. As I continued to move further and further away from that fateful day in February, I found myself mourning her death over and over again. Her absence and my loss seemed to know no limits. I grieve for the relationship we could have had as adults, the relationship she would have had with my husband, the delicious new recipes we might have exchanged, or an eye roll we might have shared at something ridiculous my dad just said. Her absence is particularly acute when shitty things happen in my life. An infertility diagnosis and loss of a much-wanted pregnancy. Supporting my sister through her mental illness. Fear in the midst of a global pandemic. The battles and anxieties that spark at the turn of a key daily in life. At one time, I would have been able to call my mother, to ask for her advice, to hear the warmth of her voice. It's in these big and tiny corners of my life that I miss her every day. When I lost my pregnancy, I was once again forced to confront the overwhelming pain and disorientation that arrive immediately following a loss. I learned that grief is love. I felt foolish for being upset over a bundle of cells, but then I realized I felt sorrow not for these cells, but because of all the love and hope I held for this future child and my role as her mother. It wasn't about how far along the pregnancy was. It was about an imagined future that would never come to pass. And I yearned for my mother during those weeks and months because of the unconditional love, support, and comfort she provided to me throughout her life. Love serves as the foundation for our most intimate relationships, so of course we grieve when those we love are no longer here to love us in the ways we've come to expect. My desire to become a mother is inextricably connected to the love I have for my mother and the love she has for me. That love is a present tense kind of love, not something that is stuck in the past. Even in death, she is mine. Grief, like love, is also limitless, which means we have to find a way to live with it, to understand that it is your deep love for the person. Your loss is yours alone. No matter who you lost or when you lost them, you deserve to honor that love. You deserve to live a full life after death while still loving them. No one can tell you how to handle your resulting grief, but my goal in sharing my stories and missteps is to provide you with a sense of comfort and community, and maybe even an occasional smile. In addition to my many foibles and occasional lessons, I wanted to ensure this book was not just about me and my story, so it is also grounded in the leading research on grief and loss. Because everyone's experience with grief is different, do not use this book as a roadmap or a set of specific instructions. Instead, I hope it might serve as a compass to help you navigate your unique journey. Marisa. Chapter 1. Permission. Permission isn't a common word in discussions about grief, but it's what's been missing. Giving yourself permission to grieve is the beginning of the journey. Permission to know that you have loved and cherished someone's life deeply and will continue to. There comes a time when you have no choice. Permission to grieve becomes required. You never understand just how useless you are as an individual, how mortal, how powerless you are, until you know that someone you love is dying and there is absolutely nothing you can do to stop it from happening. The anticipation of a day you would do anything to prevent but can't. It isn't just an emotional pain. It is all-encompassing. This feeling is felt in your headaches, insomnia, body pains, stomach aches, loss of appetite.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.